Estimated game here, Vampire Chronicles for the Sega Dreamcast. So Vampire Chronicles allows you to play as three different types of the Vampire Hunter series of games. You can play as the original Vampire, then you can play as a Hunter style, or the more recent one, the Savior style, which is the one I'm going for. So as you can see, most of the characters are there from the series. I think we'll pick Dimitri. Again, speeds are available to choose from. You've got normal, turbo, auto, and turbo. But we'll just go for turbo. Again, you can choose your fighting style. So we've got vampire type, hunter type, savior type, and savior 2 type. I'm being a bit of an idiot, I forgot to use my ASCII pad, so I'm stuck using the Dreamcast pad, which is pretty shit for fighting games, since it's only got 4 face buttons. One thing which I always liked about the Vampire Hunter series of games, and that's the animation. Except for on the PlayStation version, that is. But that can't be helped. All the Sega Saturn versions had really nice animation, and this Dreamcast version is identical to the arcade. So you may be wondering, what's the difference between the play modes? Well, for example, in a Savior mode, Savior 2 mode, when you die, you don't actually get a chance to have round 2, as you can see. It just starts straight away. So basically, it's just one big round. Add 6 button action, no? Fans of the series will also be interested to know that Vampire Chronicles on the Dreamcast features all the music from all the games as well, including a couple of unused tracks. Definitely a collection worth checking out. It's all presented in that wonderful Q sound, which Capcom likes to use on the older fighters. Sounded a bit pervy, that voice, didn't it? Another really cool feature about the Vampire series of games, all the little sneaky comical touches Capcom put in there. And sometimes when you get hit, the expressions on the characters' faces were really funny. You can only usually see them if you really look for them, or if you pause the game. But of course in the arcade that's not possible. Let's see if we can find a good one here. I always found about these games was the fact that they're actually pretty difficult compared to Capcom's other fighting games. Not too sure why. But they always seem to be a lot tougher to master. Not that long ago, Sega Direct was selling these games on really, really cheap. I'm not too sure if they still have any. But originally the game was only available from Sega Direct themselves. You couldn't actually buy this in the shops. Even though a couple of shops did seem to have a couple of copies. So Vampire Chronicles in the Dreamcast was at one point quite a sought after item. But it seems that they actually made that many of them. And couldn't sell them all. Considering it was only available through the mail order chain. So here we have Dimitri and Morrigan playing in Vampire mode. So as you can see, the engine bars at the top look completely different. The music's different as well. And what you'll notice is when she dies, you actually do get a round 2, so they're just continuing. Also the way it plays is different. So you get your little end of fight sequence there, which wasn't available in a normal version. So let's take a look at the Vampire version of the game. Okay, we're playing the Hunter version of the game, and as you can tell the music's different. The engine bars are pretty much the same though. But the playstyle again is a little bit different. Improving over what the original Vampire was. Like playing in a Vampire mode, you get the end of level sequence. Okay, now let's check out the Savior version. Here we go, Savior version. Again, different music. But no end of level fight sequence. Straight into the next fight. Of course, my favourite style of play is a Savior 2 version, but you don't have to just stick with one version of the game. You can like play Hunter version with Savior 2 style of play. But just because player 1 wants to play with Savior 2 style of play, doesn't mean player 2 has to. Each player can choose which version they want. So like for example, you could play a Vampire Hunter game, whereas player 2 is playing as the Vampire Savior style, and maybe the other player is playing as Vampire Savior 2 style, or maybe Vampire Hunter style. Your choice is all yours, which is what's good about this. Unfortunately, this game is no longer online verse, but when it was out in Japan, you could actually play online against people, thanks to part of Capcom's matching server series. Unfortunately, KDDI, who ran the service, have closed it down now. But don't worry, even without all those extras, it's still a really good fighter. It's like lots of options as well, lots of stuff to keep you going. So I'm sure fans of the series are gonna love it. So Retro Core is very happy to give Vampire Chronicles on the Sega Dreamcast a wonderful score of 9 out of 10. Definitely one of the best vampire games out there. So Suit Leynos here for the Sega Saturn. Or so Suit Leynos 2 I should say. Follow up to the Mega Drive hit. Also you might know the brand from the Super Famicom, whereas it appeared as a Suit Valken. Probably the best one in the series. How is the Sega Saturn version measured up to the other versions? Well, let's take a look. First thing you have to do is select what mech you want. So as you can see, I've got about 5 here available. This is one of my favorites. Luckily for those who can't speak Japanese, this whole game's in English. Well, the whole game's not in English, but the actual options, which are the most important parts here, are actually in English. So first of all, you gotta get your power. So you can see here I can change the levels. Then you select what weapons you want. There's quite a variety of weapons here to choose from. After that you can add extras to your mech. And select the type of armor you want, which you can also power up and down like this. Now what you got to keep an eye on is the weight limit. As you can see in the bottom left hand corner, you have a maximum load to it in blue. So if your mech weighs more than that, you can't actually use it. So there you go, we've got 255 left, so I'm safe there. One thing which I like to do is to change the screen mode. I like it on move, gives it that little bit more realistic image. It must be pointed out that I've actually finished this game 3 times now. So because I've finished it 3 times, I've got like really powerful weapons. When you first start this game, the weapons you get are really weak. And you'll find it really tough going. For example, this laser which I'm using now is not available from the beginning of the game. Depending on what type of weapon you use, the screen can actually zoom in and out as well. So as you can see, the enemies are really big. This time round, that boss takes absolutely ages to kill. So at the end of each mission, you get a rundown of how well you did. One nice little feature I like is this punch that your mechs got, which you can power up as well, just like the weapons. Can actually punch enemies on my side. And you also have a shield, which I don't have equipped at the moment. And also, you can see in the top right hand corner, it says auto. With the flick of the Z button, you can turn that to manual, which means you can move your arm or weapon in any direction you want, as you can see here. The only problem with that is that it becomes a bit confusing when flying and trying to shoot things, so I usually keep it on auto like that. But sometimes the auto doesn't go where you want it to go. One of my favourite weapons is this napalm here. If you can see that, look at that. Won't burn, you little bastards. So the game does look very easy at the moment. I'm not saying that, I just died. Really typical. So anyway, as I was saying, this game does look quite easy at the moment, but in fact it is really hard. The thing is, when you finish the game, you're allowed to continue, but you continue from the very beginning, but you still keep all your equipment from the game before. So as I said, this is my third time round, so I've actually got all the weapons from all the other games, and each time you play it, you can power up even more. So now my mech's pretty much invincible. Yeah, so if you're after a good mech action game for your Sega Saturn, you can do an awful lot worse than buy this. Suit Leynos number 2 is a very, very good game. And Retro Core's given it the score of 7 out of 10. The only thing that lets it down is like a bit short, and the fact that it can be quite tough and a bit unforgiving at times really knocks down the score quite a bit. But like I said, if you have to do a challenge, this is well worth picking up. There's enough weapons in there, enough mechs, and enough different opportunities to power up your mech as well. It's going to last you for quite a long time. I'm sure you won't be disappointed. PC Engine's got many fan shooters on it, but none of them, well, maybe some of them, but not many of them sound and play as good as this one. Fucking ace getting this one. Sounds just like a classic late 80s, well, no, not late 80s, mid 90s arcade shooter. Really fast, action paced, great audio. In fact, sounds more like a Mega Drive game than a PC Engine game. Not that I'm trying to compare the PC Engine to a Mega Drive, mind you. I know the PC Engine fans don't like that. Anyway, this is one hell of a good shooter.
money.
If there was one problem with this game, I'd say it's the fact that you can't actually change weapons. Unless the select button does it. Hang on, let's have a look. No, select button does your speed. That's not it. And that pauses it. Oh well. Yeah, so you can't actually change your weapons. Which is a bit of a bummer, because if you want to use the next weapon, you've got to actually let rip with the bomb. So as you can see, I'm using the Vulcan weapon at the moment. Use the bomb version of it though. And I go straight onto my laser. Use the laser, and then I'm back onto the Vulcan. So that is a bit of a bummer with the game. But I'm sure it can be forgiven, because the game is very fun to play. And even all these years later, it's still actually good fun to play. You know, it's a good solid shooter. One nice little feature this game has is a type of smart bomb, which happens when you collect the, well, say you got three of the same color weapon down in the bottom right hand corner. But if you collect another one of the same type, then it acts as a smart bomb and kills anything on screen at the same time, which can come in handy at some points. Take a look at the caravan stage. You get 2 minutes to play this bit, or you can change it to any time you want. We'll go for 2 minutes. So the idea is to get the highest rank and score basically in the caravan stage. For those who don't know, caravan is actually from Japan shooting contest. Very popular from Hudson, of course, the makers of this game. Wow, shit. Went the wrong way there. So anyway, Retro Core is very happy to give this game a very good score of 8 out of 10. I would actually give it more than 8 out of 10 if I had a better power-up system. But unfortunately, it's let down just a little bit by the power-up system. But if you've got a PC engine, or Turbo Graphics as they're called in the States, make sure you get yourself one of these games. Absolutely amazing shooter. Here come the massive overdrive! Violence, Suit Valken for the Super Famicom. Earlier on we saw Suit Leynos for the Sega Saturn. This one came out a bit earlier than that, and to be honest, personally I think this one's much better. So each level starts off with a quick introduction to it. But unlike the Sega Saturn version of the game, this one goes straight into the game. You can't actually choose weapons and all that. One thing you'll notice straight away about this game is actually the graphics are very nice for Super Famicom. All the robot mechs are well animated, and there's loads of little attention to detail in there, such as here when I shoot the floor, the Vulcan, you can see I take bits of the floor up. You also got the shells coming out the back of my mech from the gun. And also when you fly, watch, it leaves like a vapor trail on the floor. Here we go, if you get near the floor. See, you can just about see it there. As well as your standard controls of jump and shoot, you've also got a block, or a shield I should say, which is here. Oops, no it's not. It's here. You can use this to save yourself from enemy projectiles and so on. You've also got a choice of weapons at the moment, because we're only on level 1, all you get is the Vulcan and your punch. You're powered up separately by picking up the little icons, and you've also got a dash which goes like this, which can be very useful for getting out of sticky situations. So at the moment we're in space, so there's actually no atmosphere, which makes the mech able to float around wherever you want to go really, which is handy, saves on all that expensive jetpack fuel. Those lasers are right busted, they follow you everywhere. Obviously the graphics are a lot more chunkier than the Sega Saturn version. But overall, even though they have a cartoony look to them, I do think they look a lot better than the Sega Saturn. The detail's not as high, but there's just something about it. There's actually quite a good variety in the levels as well on this game. You got your platform walk along mech sections, and then you've even got the flying shoot along sections such as this one, which suddenly change into a battleground action. Give him a bit of a fist, there you go, bit of fisting lads. I've got my laser now. Bit weak though. Gotta power that up. Then one problem I do have with this game is the actual button layout. The default button layout is very difficult to get used to. As you keep noticing, I keep forgetting to press the shield button. Lovely attention to detail there. The physics of the game are actually very good as well. The mech that you control does actually feel as if it's heavy. I'm not too sure how NCS have managed to do this, but the controls aren't sluggish as you'd expect them to be. But they do seem to have some sort of delay to them. But they fit in perfectly with the actual game. And when you're flying, it does seem like a bit of a struggle, you know, how you'd imagine a mech to be. Whereas the assault suit on the Sega Saturn, the mech just seems to fly normally. There's no weight to it whatsoever. As you'd expect, the Assault Suit Valken is a really tough game. Just like all the Assault Suit series, really. While it may not look as if much is going on screen, it's actually quite action-packed at times. I really like this section, it shows off some of the powers of the Super Famicom. Super Famicom is actually quite a wonder for transparencies, as you can see here. Whichever direction your mech's facing, is the direction where the light shines, which is actually very nice. One thing which annoys me about the Western version of this called Cybernator is the fact that all the people think that Konami made it, when in fact Konami didn't make it. It was made by NCS Messiah, like all the other Assault Suit Valken games. And Another annoying thing about the Konami version of this game is that it's censored to death. There's loads of bits missing out of it. Gone all the lovely anime artwork from the options screen, and even the end credits are different on the Konami version. They've been changed as well. And there's a nice little scene after you kill this guy here, which is missing out of the Western version, which I'll show you as well. Just have to rebound a couple of bullets into this little bastard. Or rebound them off the wall, it's much easier. Here we go, the secret part, not in the Cybernator version by Konami. Just keep an eye on the guy in the right. A special mention must go to the music used in this game. It's absolutely amazing. The only problem is that sometimes, because the sound chip being used for the explosion sound effects and so on, that the music cuts out. The only drawback to using chip generated audio. But still, it's definitely got to be some of the most atmospheric tunes I've heard on the Super Famicom. And what's amazing is this game still plays absolutely fabulous even to this day. You know, it's like 13 years old. And it still plays really well. And there's the big end of level baddie. Which I'm not going to show you. But what I will show you is the ending to the Japanese version. So it is a bit of a spoiler, so if you don't want to see it, skip now. And so the mech army destroy all the bad guys and save the world once again. Until they re-released this game on the PS2. Completely fucked it up by sticking some really shitty filter on it to make the graphics look really naff. Plus it's got loading times. In fact, the PlayStation 2 re-release of this game is actually quite disappointing. You're far better off buying yourself a Super Famicom and a copy of the game for probably the same price. So anyway, Retro Core is very happy to give Suit Valken on the Super Famicom a grand score of 9 out of 10. Excellent title.
Battle Mania 2. First off, I have to apologize for the really naff sound quality on this. But you can thank that to the Dreamcast emulator. So Battle Mania 2 for the Sega Mega Drive by Vic Plukai. The original was released in the US under the name of Troubleshooter, but this sequel is much, much better. Just check out the reflection in the windows there. Okay, quite nice though. So Batmania 2 is like the original. The jet-packed female fighter is out to stop all the demons taking over Tokyo. Just me, or is that boss guy sound like he's got a woman's voice? Hey, and there's my partner. Right through the top story window in a car. Like that's never happened before. So as in all Japanese games, it's essential to have a story. Even though the story's complete and utter bollocks. Look at that, Shooter's rank is ordinary. I'm sad now. So between each level you get these lovely comical scenes which really add to the atmosphere of the game. The first game also had them, but they didn't look nowhere this good. Whoa, sexy. Or maybe not. What the hell is she holding? Okay, here we go, from now we should be able to switch. There we go. So I've got my two female apprentices over here. I can turn both of them facing to the right. Or turn one round so she's facing backwards. You may notice that guy from the first game, if you ever played with this. So the idea here is if you're going to shoot this little bugger, lose control on the robot, by remote control. Thank you. Battle Mania 2 is one of those games that remain... Battle Mania 2 is one of those games that remind me of the good old times that were the 16-bit days. Games back then had so much class and, you know, quality to them. You know, the amount of wackiness humor that the games had back then, you just don't seem to see these days. All it's about these days is who can make the best looking graphics in the shittest game. But all I can say is thank God that we've still got the classics. So how do I rate Battle Mania 2? Well, it's a solid enough shooter. It's fun, it's very funny. It'll keep you going for quite a long time. So I'm going to give it a score of 8 out of 10. Definitely worth picking up. Shite of the month. Here we go with Sailormoon for the Sega Saturn. Unfortunately, Saturn fans, you got this shite on your machine. Okay, now to be fair to it, it's got some nice anime cutscenes like this one. Not like the intro, which gives complete and utter crap. Ah, you're late. Right. Anyway, so they go through the god knows pointless script here. Unlike Retro Core, which is completely unscripted. That's probably more pointless. Anyway, that's besides the point. So after we watch the anime intro, which to be fair is not such bad quality, we get to the character select screen. So first you only got a choption. A choption? What the hell's a choption? At first you've only got the option to choose a few of the characters. There are actually a lot more available than this. So let's see, who do I fancy? None of them actually. So anyway, let's go Sailor Mercury. So you can have manual or auto. Manual of course. Okay, she says think about your balance. So after you've done that, you've got to decide what parts you're going to power up. So you can power up various aspects of the character. Not much choice there, was there?
Versus
Sailor Venus.
Just listen to that stereo. Amazing, isn't it? So you're probably guessing what game it is by now. Well, you're about to find out, and you probably laugh your tits off when you see it. After all, it is Shite of the Month. Here we go. Now what the hell is that? Okay, so it's a 1-on-1 beat 'em up with pre-rendered characters. Very badly pre-rendered characters. And you got a 2D background, which is just a plain picture. Nothing special there. Now, as you can probably hear, I'm bashing away at the buttons frantically. And absolutely fuck all is happening. The response time on this game is pathetic. Now, look at that. How the hell I got thrown twice there is unbelievable. There's no block either. And sometimes when you miss a move, do you do that? Do the stupid bow thing. There you go, and I'm dead. Each character has a few special moves, not many. They're really difficult to pull out. The timer is unbelievably bad. Look at that, collision detection is like non-existent almost. The computer is far too difficult to beat. And not only are the moves difficult to do, but they're absolutely pointless and badly planned. Some moves don't even work against half the characters. You find most of the time it's just better just to kick. Like that. There you go, she's bowing again for some unknown reason. Look at that. The speech samples are also really low as well. You know, it's like they've been taken from a Super Famicom game or something. Very bad speech samples. So there you have it, there's Sailormoon, Super NES, various emotions. But the only emotion I got when I played it was fucking ripped off. But then again, it only cost me the equivalent of £1, so I can't complain. Yep, I don't think we'd be continuing, so there you go. Shite of the Month. Whatever you do, don't buy it. Even you Sailormoon freaks out there, you'll be disappointed. I'm playing again. Fuck that. Crisis Force by Konami for the Famicom. Excellent shooter for all Famicom fans. It sort of reminds me of compiled Alistair games. You know, the way the enemies attack, and the way you can get your power-ups, just like that. Crisis Force is actually pretty fast as well. Actually quite surprised for the Famicom game. colors aren't that bad and the sound's quite nice. The only problem is if you keep picking up too many speed ups like me, you end up dashing all over the place. There's no way to speed yourself down except for killing yourself. Only two buttons used within the game. You've got the shoot, which is the one you can see now. And then you've got the B button, which is change. Looks more like a smartphone to me, however. Just let one rip here. Here we go. That's definitely a Super Lester ripoff. Famicom's not exactly short of shooters, there's a couple of the hundreds of them. But this is definitely one of the better ones out there, and definitely worth picking up if you can find it. And you can see the slowdown setting in a bit there, but it's still moving at a fair fast pace. Just like me. Not only is this game a really good one-player game, but it's actually two-player as well, which leads to some exciting action. Well, yeah, it does slow down a bit, but still. Very happy to give Star Crisis on the Famicom a nice score of 7 out of 10. All-time classic, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles by Konami for the arcade. I always wish they'd reported this one to the Super Famicom. No set of Turtles in Time. But instead I went to the Famicom. Well, the wire played still pretty good. Didn't look that good really. So as you can see, I'm playing as a one-player game at the moment. there a sad start and there's no one else around to play with me? Well, maybe that's what only may take games. Never mind. But yeah, when this game was out in the arcades, it was the best four-player action game out there. How does that still play, you know, all these years later? Well, that's a bit limited because you only got like a jump and an attack. Oh, what an insert credit as well. But yeah, it's still a fairly playable game. Some moves at a fair pace. And unlike the Simpsons game, also by Konami, this one actually seems to control a bit better. I always thought Simpsons had a bit of a collision detection problem. Now, who do you think's gonna come out of here? Who the fuck's that? Is that Bebop or Rocksteady? I remember now. Whoever it is gonna die. Yep, like I said, it's gonna die. Oh fuck, it's Shredder. Just a shame that the Turtles got ruined like everything else. You know, they milked everything too much, and so it loses its appeal. Ah well, never mind. One thing which this version doesn't feature, which the follow-up Turtles in Time did, was the scaling where you could actually throw the foot soldiers at the screen. In this one, they don't sort of you just fly away, really. Whoops. So considering you're never gonna have seen this in the arcades recently, or these days I should say, I think it's safe enough to say either buy the PCB, or download the ROM. But you don't want to be doing that. No, that's what all the bad boys do. Anyway. If you do ever actually see this in the arcades these days, make sure you have a game. I'm going to give this a lovely score of 8 out of 10. Great multiplayer action fighting game. Thanks to Konami. Now don't forget the Sega Game Gear is just basically a mass system. So how well would it cope with porting a Mega Drive game to it? Well, as you can see, actually very good. Makes me wonder if the new Game Boy Advance version is going to be any better. Well, of course it will be. But considering this is from another Game Gear, this is very impressive. Unfortunately, the sound let it down a little bit, but still, it's not a bad rendition of the original tunes. I know what you're thinking. Is the 3D Blockman gonna be there? Well, be prepared to be surprised. Here he comes, in Game Gear glory. Well, okay, doesn't look as good as the Mega Drive one, but still, it's not too bad for the Game Gear. So with the Game Gear only having two buttons, you're probably wondering how you change your weapon. Well, that's the beauty of a start button, you see. One press of the start button changes the weapon. But then again, how'd you pause it? Well, the longer you keep your finger on the button, the different results you get. So a quick press of the start button will just pause the... change your weapon. If you keep your finger held down on the start button, that'll actually pause the game. Like that. And flick it away as well. There we go. There's a little option that I like here, so you can actually choose what level you want to go on. It's just a shame that Treasure never brought this game out on the Mass System, because it'd be really good to play on the big TV. Whoops! But if you can find the copy, I would seriously recommend picking this up. It definitely shows you what your Game Gear can do if programmed properly. It plays every bit just as well as the original Mega Drive version, and it looks pretty nice as well, especially on that small screen. So Retro Core is very happy to give Gunstar Heroes on the Sega Game Gear a very nice score of 8 out of 10. First time I played it, I couldn't put it down for hours.